That may be the greatest catch I've ever seen in my life.
All right, guys. I know y'all are not going to like this video. I will say that right away. But before we get into it, before we talk about Javonte Williams, what I need to do is I need to thank everyone who's a part of Notification Gang, everyone who's been coming out to the premieres, and we've been able to just chat in the live chat as we all watch the video. Go through, I can answer your questions, and it's a lot easier than me going down to the comment section to answer your questions. So as always, feel free to comment any questions that you have. But if you want something really answered and you go, you know what, Mason, I appreciate the show. I can't support on Patreon. I can't have access to your DMs all day. But there's one last thing you can do. What you can do is you can go, you can subscribe to the channel. More importantly, though, this is the number one thing. Hit the bell next to the subscribe button. That way you get notified whenever we go live. You can come out to the premiere where I'm hanging out with everybody that has that bell hit. And I just chat along, answer all your questions throughout the course of the video. So yeah, I just want to thank everybody who's been showing up as of late. I mean, we've been getting like 40, 50 people all in there at once, and it's just a fantastic time. But anyway, this video has to be made. I know that a lot of people want to just hear, oh, Javonte Williams is going to be the next Alvin Kamara. Javonte is going to be the next Miles Sanders. And while, yeah, there are some things that we like about his profile. They're not all negatives. I'll say that there are a lot of things that we can get excited about. There are some things that I am worried about that I have not heard other people discuss. Now, I know a lot of other people really are just wanting views, and how you want views and how you get those is by coming out and saying a player is going to be elite, saying a player is going to be dominant at the NFL, where if you look at historical hit rates, most of the time, the people that are right are the people coming out and going, you know what? What we need to look at is we need to look at a little bit more of the negatives. What are the red flags in this profile? And I think there are a few. Now, the number one red flag, we are going to get into a little bit more detail with this at the end of the video, but it's going to be the fact that I think that Javonte Williams is just higher up in a lot of dynasty players' minds than he is with the NFL draft community. And we know that this is a problem that we see every year in dynasty fantasy football, where we have a big problem going through. And if you don't know really what a lot of these dynasty analysts do, is they go through and they go, okay, it's time for me to get my dynasty rookie takes. It's time for me to get my dynasty rookie rankings. Let's look at what this analyst I respect has. Let's take what he has, then I'll put my opinion on that, and that's how I'll get my rankings. And why this is so bad is pretty much it just makes us so susceptible to groupthink that a lot of the time there will be a player that the dynasty community just gets way wrong. Before the NFL draft, every single year there's a player that we are significantly higher on than real life NFL teams. If we just go through most recent examples, I mean, in 2020, everybody loved Bryan Edwards. A lot of people thought Bryan Edwards was going to be an early second round NFL draft pick. He ended up falling to the third to the Las Vegas Raiders. We know how that's played out so far. 2019, the most famous example of this is a lot of dynasty analysts had Hakeem Butler as their wide receiver one. Then Hakeem Butler falls to the fourth round in the NFL draft. In 2018, a lot of people had Royce Freeman near the very top. If you don't know who Royce Freeman is, he's pretty much just wasted away in Denver. And a lot of people thought that he was going to be in that same tier of someone like Nick Chubb, just at the top of the rookie class. He ends up falling to the third round to the Denver Broncos. And if we want to go in that same draft class, an example probably as good as the Hakeem Butler one was Equanimeous St. Brown, where a lot of people thought that he would potentially be a first or second round NFL draft pick. A lot of people were willing to rank him as a top three wide receiver in that 2018 class. Then he falls to outside the fourth round. I believe he went in the fifth round to the Green Bay Packers, if memory serves. And then 2017, Josh Reynolds out of A&M. Another scenario where a lot of people in Dynasty, a lot of analysts, love Josh Reynolds. And all these players I talked about, they had strengths. They had things on their profile that were fun. But at the same time, they also had some red flags that weren't discussed enough. So let's dive into Javonte Williams, because I think that he kind of fits this mold currently, where Javonte Williams, I'll say, coming out of high school, not really on the radar. He was a three-star prospect, and I know pretty much nobody talks about this in Dynasty. Nobody talks about high school recruit rank. Now, I will say, for my biostatistics class, I had to write a thesis, I had to do a research paper, and I spent an entire semester researching how high school recruit rank impacts different positions and their NFL success. And unsurprisingly, there was really no correlation with a lot of other positions with a lot of wide receivers. I mean, literally a five-star high school wide receiver pretty much has the same exact chances of hitting at the NFL level as someone who's a two or three star, just because we are very bad at evaluating high school level prospects. But surprisingly, at the running back position, very few guys come out of nowhere. Very few guys just pop off the scene and go, hey, look at me. Y'all overlooked me in high school. Generally, the guys that make an impact are like other players in this class, Travis Etienne, Najee Harris, both guys at the very top of their respective high school recruiting classes coming out, both guys who went to legit programs in Clemson and Alabama. Regardless, that's not a death nail. That's like a very, very, very small red flag. Honestly, don't even know if I need to be bringing it up, but it helps us in the video. So anyway, let's go through and let's talk about some positive things that we're going to see from Javonte Williams. One, his size. Right now, he's listed at 5'10", 220 pounds. And now, no, this is not an official size for him. So he's probably going to be a little bit smaller than this if you just understand how schools list their players compared to what their official numbers are once they get to their pro day, once they get to the NFL Combine. But something that's really, really nice with Javonte Williams right now and has a strong correlation to NFL draft success is the fact that he came out after only three seasons. And on top of that, he is going to only be 21 years old at the time of the NFL draft. Right now, he's only 20 years old. And if you look at historical hit rates, that's fantastic for Javonte Williams. You love to see him check that box. And there are a few other boxes that you love to see checked by Williams. First off, I'll say that he is not going to be a great athlete. I mean, he is definitely a little bit more agile than athletic testing should predict or should show more so. So don't be expecting him to come out on his pro day and blow you away with his 40-yard dash time. Yet, at the same time, he has some traits that we like. If you go through and if you look at what he's able to do in breaking through tackles, we had one of my favorite people in the world sending me stuff on Twitter going through his percent tackles broken. And Javonte Williams is elite at breaking tackles. Shout out to Justin Nash, JN. Thank you, my dude. So that's one thing that we have to point out. I will say we have a little bit of hesitation saying that he's going to have that long field breakout speed like a Derrick Henry, but we don't need to go there. Let's talk about his production profile. Let's talk about what he was actually able to do in college. And in 2018, his true freshman year, pretty much nothing. I mean, he averaged less than a reception a game, averaged four carries, less than 30 total yards, but he wasn't a big-time prospect, so nobody was expecting him to be able to go from being a three-star recruit to automatically dominating the touches in his backfield his 18-year-old season. Now, in 2019, on the other hand, this is where he took a massive step up. He went to 13 carries a game and about a reception and a half. And I'll say, I know a lot of people are going to see a reception and a half and kind of roll their eyes at it, that I'm even bringing it up. But no, that's a good number. I mean, you want to see a sophomore year 19-year-old be able to average over a reception. Generally, how running backs are used at the college level doesn't have them coming out and seeing the same amount of targets out of the backfield as they would in the NFL. So that number is fine by me. And in 2020, more importantly, this is his big time season. He comes out over 14 carries a game, over 130 total yards a game, and two touchdowns a game. Now, yes, two total touchdowns, so receiving and rushing, but still, he's getting that goal line usage. And we know that when you are scoring that often, the yards per carry is going to be completely skewed just because you find yourself hitting a wall. So don't even bother looking at the yards per carry with Javonte Williams when he is scoring this much. And also, a big, big thing that we saw is 2.5 receptions a game from Javonte Williams. That checks the reception box. I do not have too many concerns about what he's going to do at the NFL level and if he's going to be limited as a receiver. So great on that front. But on the flip side, let's go through and let's look at that same backfield in 2020. And this is something else that I'm a little bit worried about. Okay, so Michael Carter, came in, and let's compare him just stat by stat with Javonte Williams. So let's go. Javonte Williams averaged 14 carries a game. Michael Carter, 14. Okay, total yards, Javonte Williams, 131. Michael Carter, 137. Okay, touchdowns per game, Javonte Williams, 2. Michael Carter, 1. Receptions per game, 2.2, and then 2.2. Okay, so yeah, Michael Carter is not going to be near the same level prospect of Javonte Williams. If you just look at the size, Carter's down there at like 5'8", sub 200 pounds. So yes, those are not official numbers. Once we get the weigh-in, once we get the height at the pro day, we can definitely update that. But just to know that Javonte Williams was having to share a backfield with someone else who was a sub-sized running back that was only a three-star prospect is definitely something we have to worry about. I will point out that Michael Carter was a senior. Javonte Williams was a junior. That does make a difference. But still, when you see a running back only command a committee-sized role on his college offense, that is very worrisome with what he is going to do in the NFL if he's going to have fantasy success. I will say there are running backs who have done it before. There are running backs who have come out and been able to blow people away as only a committee running back in college. We can go back to Alvin Kamara coming out of Tennessee. That is a very, very high-end comparison. Obviously, Alvin Kamara is much more of a pass catcher. But still, Joe Mixon shared a running back backfield with Samaje Perine. Samaje Perine was very similar to Michael Carter, where they're not similar running backs in the slightest. Perine is a monster, and Carter is a little bit undersized. But it's kind of funny that Michael Carter is pretty much just an afterthought right now in NFL draft circles and dynasty circles, where Javonte Williams is getting all the hype. Same thing that happened with Mixon and Samaje Perine back in 2017. But yeah, there are instances when you see those committee running backs find success at the NFL level. But when you see those, it's when they get the NFL draft capital. And this is going to be so important for Javonte Williams. And this is why I think he is currently overvalued in dynasty formats. Because I know we have not had access to a ton of NFL mock drafts by guys who kind of have a pulse on what's going on. Guys who can get in the circles, get in the meeting rooms that we can't. And kind of have a conversation going, okay, you're looking at who here? What have you heard about player X? Where do you think they're going to go? Because usually those mock drafts have a decent chance at giving us a range where we should be expecting a player. Now, I'll say, obviously, by no means is an exact science. By no means are you going to see a mock draft say, hey, this player is going to go at 21. And he can end up going at 40. But at least you have a good idea of, okay, he's going to be at the very minimum a day two pick. We don't have to worry about him falling to day three. And with our limited sample right now, Javonte Williams is kind of all over the board. I mean, you go through, you look, some people have Javonte Williams in the fourth round of the NFL draft. I mean, a common landing spot I've seen is 121 to the Baltimore Ravens. Another common landing spot I've seen is in the third round to the Arizona Cardinals. And while both of those landing spots look fantastic, while we would assume that if he was able to get the starting role on either one of those teams, that Javonte Williams would be able to find success. But then you go through and you go, okay, what we should do is we should take a step back. We should try to approach this objectively. And let's look at the historical hit rates for the wide receivers. I'm sorry, the running backs drafted in rounds 3 and 4 over the past 5 seasons. And let's go over this list because it is not pretty. Okay, first, let's do 2020, where in the third round, we had Keyshawn Vaughn, Zach Moss, Darrington Evans. In the fourth round, we had Joshua Kelly, LaMichael Perine, Anthony McFarlane, and DJ Dallas. And then in 2019, in the third round, we had Daryl Henderson, David Montgomery, Devin Singletary, Damian Harris, Alexander Mattison. In the fourth round, you have Bryce Love, Justice Hill, Benny Snell, Tony Pollard. And then 2018, third round, you had Royce Freeman. Fourth round, Nyheim Hines, Mark Walton, Kalen Ballage, Chase Edmonds. 2017, this is where it's good. This is like the very few instances that this actually works out. You got Kamara, you got Kareem Hunt, Donta Foreman, who I would argue would have been a success if it wasn't for the Achilles tear. James Conner in the fourth. You have Samaje Perine, Tariq Cohen, Joe Williams, Donnell Humphrey, Jamal Williams, Wayne Gallman, and Marlon Mack. 2016, you had Kenyon Drake, Tyler Irvin, Kenneth Dixon, and Devontae Booker. So if we just go through and we recap this. Okay, so in the third round over the past 5 years, we've seen 14 running backs drafted, and only 4 have had produced a good season so far in their NFL careers. Now, I'll say yes, maybe you can make the argument, but Mason, Zach Moss hasn't had a full chance. Sure. Okay, I'll give you that. But anyway, out of those 14 running backs, we've only seen four of them actually look decent at the NFL level. That's been Alvin Kamara, Kareem Hunt, James Conner, and David Montgomery. And then if we go to the fourth round, this is where it's disgusting. This is where, like, oh my God, what were we doing drafting running backs here? Where 19 of them were drafted and none of them panned out. I mean, the best guys you could point to, Marlon Mack, Tariq Cohen, Nyheim Hines, none of those guys provided a ton of fantasy value. I mean, Wayne Gallman, maybe in a stretch in 2020, but he was off waivers, so that doesn't even really count. So I'll say that right now, if Javonte Williams actually ends up going in the third or fourth round of the NFL draft, I'm going to be worried. If he goes in the fourth round, he's completely off my board. I know someone else will take him higher than I do. If he goes in the third, I'll say he has a chance. I would like to see him get a little bit more draft capital than that, but still, I'm not going to write him off completely. And now, I mean, in these mock drafts that we are doing, these rookie mock drafts, just because Javonte Williams is the clear number three running back, people are pushing him up the board way too high. I mean, I've seen him go ahead of Ja'Marr Chase. I've seen him consistently go ahead of Devontae Smith. And every draft, I've seen him go ahead of Rondale Moore, Rashad Bateman, Jalen Waddle. Jalen Waddle is going to be like a top 15 pick in the NFL. So I'll say that unless we see Javonte Williams get drafted in round three or earlier, if he's drafted in round two, what I'm going to do is I'm going to take this video, throw it in the garbage, completely forget that you ever watched it, because then it's a completely different story. But I think most likely Javonte Williams is going to be a round three NFL draft pick. And I think if you look historically, his odds of succeeding in that range are going to be a little bit lower than you would say with some of these wide receivers. And a Devontae Smith, who is going to get top 10 NFL draft capital. Ja'Marr Chase, who's going to get top 10 NFL draft capital. Rondale Moore, there we're a little bit uncertain, but I mean, Rondale Moore is just such an exciting player. Same thing with Rashad Bateman, Jalen Waddle, top 15 NFL draft capital. So I know this is boring, but I just want everybody to pump the brakes. I want everybody to have a little bit more of a realistic expectation on what Javonte Williams' dynasty value should be, because I've also seen him go ahead of Clyde Edwards-Helaire in a startup draft that was $150. I mean, yeah, I have nothing else to say here. Okay, that's it. We're going to end the video there. I mean, right now, if Javonte Williams is going to continue to go in the first round, I think I will not own him in a single league, in super flex leagues, that is. But let me know if you think I'm wrong. Let me know what you think of the entire situation down in the comment section below. And as always, if y'all enjoyed the video, give it a thumbs up. Go down there, subscribe to the channel. It helps us out a ton. And yeah, I'll see y'all with the video tomorrow.